Hi, I'm Tamara, and this is TELUS Talks with Tamara Taggart. Hi, everyone. Today, I'm so happy to welcome back Dr. Olav Krigolson. He's a neuroscientist. He was on the podcast in April of 2020. It seems like it was just yesterday, but boy, oh boy, a lot has changed and a lot has stayed the same. Find out what he says about what isolation is doing to our brains and what all this change of information is doing to our brains. Hi, Olav. It's so good to see you.
It's good to see you again. Glad to be back.
I can't believe it. So the last time we spoke, you were one of my first guests. It was April of 2020, and it feels like a lifetime ago. Some things have changed and some things have stayed the same.
That's definitely a true statement.
Oh my gosh. So I was just telling you before we started recording that I tested positive for COVID a couple weeks ago. I'm still feeling pretty rotten. Were you able to escape COVID?
Oh, not at all. I had COVID at the outset. I remember I flew back from Ottawa right before they started locking things down the very first time. And I was extremely sick for a couple of weeks, and I had all of the classic COVID symptoms. And I never tested because that was actually before testing. But in hindsight, I'm convinced that was COVID. And then I got, like most of British Columbia, I got some form of Omicron over the Christmas holidays. And that wasn't too bad. But then, as I was mentioning to you, that transitioned to pneumonia, which wasn't that fun. And I've yet to hear whether there's a definitive link, but I've definitely heard a few medical types suggest that there may be links.
Wow. But you're doing okay now.
I am back to physically as normal as I can be. I taught my last class of the 2021-2022 academic year this morning. So it's always a good thing.
Wow. So for people that didn't hear our first interview, how dare you? It was in April of 2020. Dr. Krigolson is at the University of Victoria. You now have your own podcast. We'll talk about that a little bit later on. And your expertise is really cognitive neuroscience. And I remember when we talked last time, I was really interested in what isolation does to us. Because, like I said, we were about a month into staying at home last time we talked, and I was really feeling it, and you were feeling it, and people were really feeling it. But things have, you know, I mean, really, depending on who you are and what your circumstances are, there are people that are vulnerable and immunocompromised who have been in isolation for a couple of years now. And we talked about what that does to your brain, and it's really fascinating. So maybe we can talk about where we're at now and what your thoughts are on how people are doing in general after 2 years of this.
Yeah, well, COVID is basically what you want to do if you want to create mental health problems for people. It's the whole lockdown experience is a challenging thing for us to deal with. We're used to being out and about in the world and doing things. You know, that we had that one intense lockdown at the start and then a couple of sort of more minor versions as we went through. I think that the hardest part for people, especially at this 2 year mark, is that we sort of live in a world where our brain is trying to build a view of how the world works. What are the rules of this game? Right. And the ups and downs of COVID, you know, like at Christmas when we all thought that, hey, we're going to have a normal Christmas this year, and the next thing you know, we're back into this. That's really hard for our brains to adapt with when the rules of the game are changing that quickly, especially when we're not gathering the information ourselves so much as we're relying on others to tell us information. You know, we get bombarded with a bunch of different sources of information, and that stresses the brain. So we're putting a lot of stress on the brain. So you've got an increase in people experiencing depression. You know, you've got an increase in people that are dealing with anxiety issues. And that's just a byproduct of this sort of topsy-turvy, up-down world that we're living in. That's sort of naturally what should happen. It's kind of like, I wouldn't, in light of the Ukraine, I wouldn't want to use this exact wording, but it's not unlike being in a war situation where the world is changing, it's stressful, it's beyond your control, and that takes an impact on our brain. In fact, I've been talking a lot with people recently about, you know, how do you achieve good brain health, you know, given this kind of a situation.
How do you achieve good brain health when we're, you know, we're some of us have been home. We have kids that we're worried about, elderly people that we're worried about. So how do we? You're feeling, you're right, right? We're not in control of this. We want to be in control of things. We're used to being in control, I guess, of our own lives to a certain extent, right? Where
yep.
we can go out and do things. And it's a tough one.
Well,
it's hard.
What you can do about it are sort of like the three classics plus a few extras. So the three classics are like the number one probably thing you can do for good positive brain health is sleep and achieving good sleep quality. And a lot of people throughout the pandemic have talked about sleep disruptions due to stress and other factors. So anything you can do to ensure that you get a good night's sleep is crucial when you're in these kind of situations. And then the other two that sort of come up, it, I always feel like it's the dad or mom advice, but it's, you know, diet and exercise, which is, you know, it's not the time to stop your exercise program. It's time to get out and even just a walk. Like I try to get out every morning for a walk for an hour, just to get your steps in or however you choose to exercise. And then of course, diet, you know, we know across the pandemic that liquor sales have gone up dramatically compared to pre-pandemic. I've never seen an official stat on ice cream sales, but I would imagine they're doing something similar. And this is not the time for that, right? Like for good brain health, this is when you want to be following the Canada Food Guide and eating healthy and watching alcohol intake, because all of these things promote good brain health. And then the other two that are sort of out there, which I guess is the more modern version of positive brain health, is anything you can do that relates to mindfulness. You know, some people do yoga, some people meditate, some people just do breathing exercises. So for some people, it's just sitting out quietly in nature. But stuff like that has a very positive impact on the brain. There's no doubt about that. The evidence is overwhelming. And then the last one, which we kind of know within the pandemic, the pandemic forced us to be socially isolated, but you know the literature that looks at people as they get older that are socially isolated versus people that stay socially engaged. People that stay socially engaged have much better mental health outcomes. Sorry. So you know this idea of getting out, you know, and even if it was that era where we're all, you know, a lot of us got on Zoom on a Friday night with some friends or whatever. That's not as good as meeting someone in person, but it's better than not engaging at all. So there's sort of five sort of main things that you can do to achieve positive brain health, given mm-hmm. the pandemic.
Mm-hmm. And I remember us talking about this because we were, you know, just starting with the Zooms and all that. And you and I talked about how, you know, when we would be in a lineup outside of a grocery store and how excited we were to see the person in front of us. And we'd only been 3 weeks into this. So, you know, I'm thinking about here we are and a lot of us are feeling lonely. Like that's what I hear from my friends and people in you know my circle. Very lonely. You can be surrounded by your family. You can see your friends on Zoom or you know talk to them on the phone, but there is a real loneliness out there. And when you feel lonely, that leads to all kinds of other things. And you talked about, you know, alcohol and ice cream and all of those things. And those are, you know, we I guess we're looking to self-soothe, right? We're looking for things to soothe ourselves or to numb ourselves because we're feeling so lost.
No, that's exactly why. It's you know, if you're stuck home alone, I spent a fair bit of the last year of the pandemic basically by myself in my house with my son occasionally being with me. And you might make choices that you wouldn't normally make, you know. I can honestly say that I'd probably never had a beer on a Tuesday night before in my life. But, you know, then yeah. It was like, why not, right? You know, I've been trying to keep my diet in check, but definitely my let's just say that I'd gone from never using skip the dishes in my life to skip the dishes being on speed dial. And that's just your brain, things you can control. Like from a neuroscience perspective, it's you're trying to put some sort of happiness into your world or some sort of perceived enjoyment because your brain's craving that. Like, you know, at the end of the day, we seek those kind of things. And You know, I don't.
You're saying exactly the things that I'm experiencing too, right? Like, I've, you know, what time does happy hour start at? Like, it's that's how you know you talk to your friends, you know, in the last couple of years because you are lonely and you're trying to find some sort of happiness or connection or something.
And our lives have fundamentally changed. I know for me, one I've struggled with is pre-pandemic. I was doing about 100,000 miles a year for work with Air Canada. So conferences around the world, you know, that led to interacting with friends and things like that. Heck, my poor mother lives in New Zealand and I haven't seen her for 2 years. I used to fly out every 6 months. And that, you know, our lives have just changed, whether it was, you know, the travel angle or everyone's got their own thing that changed, but our lives were drastically altered. And again, our brains struggle with this because they're used to sort of, this is what I do and this is how my world works. And like I said, the seesaw stuff, and I can give you a good example, which is I'm off to Toronto next week for some in-person meetings, which it's kind of weird to get back to this concept of we're going to be in a room together. And then I'm out for my morning walk this morning listening to the news. And what do I hear? But Ontario is doing 100,000 cases of COVID a day. And it's going, well, I was so excited to go to Toronto 2 days ago, and now I'm wondering whether I should go at all.
Yeah. So what does that do to your brain? Well, your brain is just trying to figure this out, right?
Yeah, basically one of the prominent theories is the left hemisphere of your brain, specifically the frontal parts up here. It sort of maintains your worldview. It's saying this is the way the world works, and these are the rules of the game, like I said earlier. And the right side of your brain, is the frontal part, is questioning that and constantly trying to change it. But it's not supposed to do it on a day-to-day basis or an hour-to-hour basis. It's supposed to sort of be a slower adaptation. And that constant revisioning of the world model, well, that causes stress. That causes anxiety because it's just a byproduct of you just constantly trying to adapt. And you could imagine a simpler version of this, which is you're just, you know, you're playing cards with your friends or something, or tennis, and then the person you're playing with just keeps changing the rules on you. You know, we're going to use these lines, not those lines. You know, I get 2 points, you get one. You know, and that would lead to frustration and all the things we're experiencing. And that's what we find, right? You know, I was surprised this week just out of nowhere. Okay, by the way, vaccine passports are gone, right? In four days or 5 days. And that's hard for us to deal with because we, you know, now you've got people who are angry about that because they're going, well, what was the point of this? And that again creates stress and anxiety and hard for us to deal with.
Yeah. And I mean, there is a lot of discourse, right? And that happens. And we have social media, and a lot of us are on social media too much because we're lonely and, you know, we're trying to connect and stay informed. And, you know, we tend to be attracted to the voices that agree with us, if you will. And then when you see somebody that doesn't agree with you, then, you know, your brain just sort of, you know, fires off. And I mean, it's so fascinating. So is it fair for, I feel like my brain is not as sharp as it used to be. Does that make sense to you? It's not as sharp as it used to be.
It does make sense because the getting out in the world and interacting with the world sort of keeps you on point, if you will. Your brain is constantly having to think and do things, whereas this sort of stay at home life that we're in, I think it's easier for us to be an autopilot. And your brain, you know, if it doesn't have to make a lot of complex choices, it just relies on some simple heuristics or rules of thumb. And you're not challenging your brain as much as you might. This is kind of what I was alluding to earlier. There's all this really cool research that shows that people that retire, that just sit at home and watch TV, have poor mental health and mental, intelligence outcomes relative to people that stay engaged and get out there. Well, we're kind of in that group of people that are just sitting home watching TV all the time. Like, I can honestly say I went from never really watching TV other than sports to, you know, like a lot of us binge watching whatever, pick your random series on whatever, you know, streaming service you have.
Yeah. Yeah. I know. It's so true. So when, you know, we talked a lot about decision making and how, you know, it really isolation affects our brain's ability to make good decisions. And so now we're seeing, as you mentioned, you know, vaccine cards lifted, Hey, you don't need to wear a mask anywhere anymore. Everything's back to normal. Let's move into an endemic. All of that sort of stuff. How does that now affect our decision making?
Well, like I was just saying that you want some challenge in your life, but too much challenge is a bad thing too. Like if you're constantly in under a conditions of uncertainty, which is what I feel like we are with all these changes all the time, and inconsistent information, you know, that stresses your brain as well. Like this is just literally, COVID is almost an experiment in what you would do to create mental health problems. And I think that's something that a couple of my friends that are neuropsychologists are starting to talk about. You know, the next wave of COVID won't be a disease wave. It's going to be all of the mental health stuff that happens post-COVID, because people are going to have post-traumatic stress disorder. You know, just simple things like these rules changing. People are going to be sitting there going, well, what's next? What's next? What's next? And like I said, I find the information piece fascinating because I'm trying to plan some trips to Europe for work, and I honestly can't tell you what the current rules are, and you know, what do I need a test? Don't I?
I don't think a lot of people know what they are, and I think that that's part of the challenge for our brains, as you said, because we've been, you know, in, I guess, our brains have been in survival mode, yet we're at home. And now it's like, okay, hey, like, you don't need to do this. And I still, like you, I don't know what I need. Like, do I need to test to go here but not come back? And do I need to? So it's easier for me with 3 kids to just stay home. Like, that's how I feel. It's just easier to stay home.
I understand. I live in a beautiful part of Victoria where I can go for a morning walk. I've got a grocery store within walking distance and I can walk to work. So it's kind of like, it's just easier just to keep doing this. And that's kind of what I mean about this sort of default status of, like, if the world is too challenging, it might force your decisions more that way. And it's been interesting throughout the pandemic too, because we talked a bit about like the information and how it flows. And I know that Dr. Henry and her team have done the best job possible in a very difficult time. But I remember back when I had my Christmas COVID exposure, you know, we thought we were quarantining for 10 days, and all of a sudden we were quarantining for 5 days. And, you know, even knowing the situation quite well and having a few people I could phone, I was going, like, what's going on, right? And then you had a wave of people that thought it was unsafe and they were voluntarily quarantining. And this is a challenging environment for your brain. So if people are, like, stressed or frustrated, it's perfectly natural given what's happening in the world. And given what we're exposed to.
Yeah, I mean, and I guess that's reassuring hearing that from you, that it's perfectly normal to feel this way. But then, you know, I mean, I think that we've all faced struggles when it comes to our mental health, especially in the last couple of years. And, you know, you mentioned, you know, the public health office, and I agree, right? I mean, this is unprecedented. This is, you know, this is outrageously complicated, and there's way too many voices and all that sort of stuff. But is it natural for people to want to find someone or something to blame? Is that a natural thing for our brains to do? Like now we want to be angry at someone or something?
Well, yes. This is a response in the sense that if you get hurt, right? Like, so someone causes you hurt or upsets you, your brain is struggling to figure out, you know, why, like what happened? What do we point at? Right. And to have, it's easy to blame somebody. It's harder to look at this and appreciate that, you know, the public health office is dealing with imperfect information that changes on a day-to-day basis. So they're trying their best. You know, they are trying their best. It's not like they're sitting there going, let's just do this and see what happens. But that's a hard thing to comprehend sometimes, especially if you don't have access to the whole process. So it's a lot easier just to point at something, right? And that's kind of what your brain does, is it's looking for cause and effect relationships, right? Like, if I do this, what happens? And you can use that same logic for assigning blame, which is, you know, this has happened to me. What caused it? because your brain is trying to sort out, like, again, like, how the world works and how do I avoid this? And
right.
So yeah. And the other thing, too, with this is this state. I should say that the state that we've created with COVID, with this stress and anxiety, another thing this does is there's a part of your brain called the amygdala, which is responsible for your emotions. Well, everyone's amygdala is on overdrive, right? Like, there's all these studies that show that if you're sleep deprived, your amygdala fires more than it normally does. If you're tired, it fires more than it normally does. If your diet's poor, it fires more than it normally does. So all of these things that are sort of being created by COVID within the brain have forced this part of this, the part of the brain responsible for emotions, to be working on overdrive, which is why you see people flaring up and getting angry and stuff is more than they might normally.
Right. That makes sense. Yeah. I think we've all heard about the amygdala and we know what it does. And so it makes sense that it would be stressed at this time after 2 years of this.
So as opposed to sort of responding with these sort of normal like responses, it's got these big spiky responses, which are, you know, the reason you might snap or you, ah, what's going on? As opposed to going, oh, okay.
Exactly. Okay, so I want to ask you about kids and isolation. But before we do that, we always like to thank our guests. We didn't do this when we talked in April of 2020, but we'd like to thank our guests for their time, and we asked our guests to choose a Canadian nonprofit. You chose Covenant House in Vancouver, which is providing shelter, food, and immediate crisis care and services to homeless youth. And we will be giving them $500 in your name. So thank you very much, Olav, for choosing them.
Well, my pleasure. And thank you for doing that. It's an amazing gesture.
Yeah, well, it's the least we can do for your time. So thank you. So let's talk about kids for a second, because we've been talking about, you know, I feel like we've been talking about the adult brain. What about a child? Are kids more resilient? Like, we always hear that kids are so resilient. They can handle anything. They don't know any different. There are some kids that were born at the beginning of this pandemic and they haven't seen anyone or been to play groups or anything like that.
It's hard on them. It depends on the age of the kid you're talking about. If you start with the young ones, they're probably the most adaptable because they're just making sense. You know, this is the world that they know, right? Now, in terms of social development, you know, normally a normal transition out is, you know, you're with primary care. And then part of, you know, as the brain matures is the social side of the brain, which, you know, we're trying our best to do, but it's limited, you know. You know, my teenage son is quite happy to be on Zoom with his friends. If he was 2 years old, you know, you don't really do that. If you move into the older kids, where they struggle is that the last part of the brain to develop is the prefrontal cortex, so this bit at the front. And that's the part that you're using to logically assess things. This is why our teenagers make such interesting choices at times, is because the logical part of the brain isn't quite there yet. So they're probably struggling a bit more because as this logical brain system is developing, you know, their ability to question the world and roll with the punches, you know, is a little bit different than ours. I think it'll be interesting to see how kids are impacted. Now, the nice thing is the resiliency side of it, which is I never really got into the Zoom conversations with my friends. I could do it for about 20 minutes and then I was like, all right, well, I'll see you guys later. Whereas he'll happily spend hours chatting with his friends online. So kids also have this adaptation skill that we as adults may or may not possess to the same extent.
Mm. And what about our seniors? Like, I feel like really that's where I find it really difficult to, I feel like, you know, here we have this large chunk of the population who have been isolated in, you know, the you know, the twilight years of, you know, these are the years that they're supposed to see their grandkids and hang out and just like enjoy life and all those things. And many are in long-term care homes and they haven't been able to see their loved ones. You talk about the brain and the need for, you know, socialization and connection. What does that do to our senior brain?
Nothing good. Mentioned once or twice earlier, as you get older, that social interaction becomes absolutely crucial. And I mentioned the kind of research that looks at seniors that are socially isolated versus seniors that aren't. And the outcomes for socially isolated seniors aren't as good as the ones that still have social engagement. So it's been incredibly hard on them. Because, the exercise stuff may get a bit more limited in terms of maintaining good brain health. As we get older, it's pretty natural that our sleep isn't as good a quality as when we're younger. You know, diet to some extent still within their purview, but that social piece is then, you know, you're trying to use that to compensate for some of the other stuff. So removing that from them is incredibly hard on them. The one plus, I guess, in their favor is they do have a lot more life experience, if you will, to possibly deal with it. Now, they probably haven't lived through another pandemic, but they might have gone through some other stressful points in their lives where at least they can sort of refer back to and go, okay, you know.
Right.
This wasn't as bad as you know, event X. But I would say that it's having a massive toll on them. And again, these are the kind of things, this is, like I said, this is the next phase of the pandemic is going to be this mental health assessment. We know that divorce rates shot up through the pandemic, right? We know all sorts of sort of problems. It's going to be interesting to see the repercussions of the pandemic, because they're going to, like, we know that financially it's going to take a while to clear up all that's happened, but the mental health side is going to be, in my opinion, going to be massive.
Yeah, well, and it's interesting that you say that, because we know before the pandemic it was impossible almost for somebody to find therapy, psychiatrists, psychologists. I mean, there's long, long wait lists for people to find somebody to talk to. Most people can't afford it. It's very expensive. So, I mean, if you're concerned about that, and we put the fact that, you know, getting help was hard before the pandemic, it's going to probably be even harder to get that help after the pandemic if there's even more people that need that.
Oh, there's no doubt about that. I'm not ashamed to say that I work with the counselor, and he's swamped. Like he's doing extra hours just to try to accommodate people, and I'm sure he's not the only one that does that, right? It's gonna be interesting. I didn't live through these events, but you know, I've read about them. But you know, after the Second World War, there was this massive swath of people that had all these sort of issues because they'd gone through this horrible time. This hasn't, you know, as bad as COVID has been. It wasn't obviously not as bad as the Second World War, but it is going to create PTSD and stuff like that in a subset of the population. And it'll be, only time will tell. I think the one positive about this happening is there were people that were talking about, you know, the next big thing for humanity is going to be these kind of viral pandemics. And our awareness is at least raised, in terms of that, well, what if this happens again? What can we do now to prepare for it?
Oh boy. Okay. So let's talk about what you're up to now. You have a podcast. You were talking about it. It was an idea that you had, and now you're doing it. You said you have 100,000 downloads. I mean, this is so good. What do you do on it's the neuroscience guy, right?
It's that neuroscience guy. It's on just about anything. It sort of started, I was doing some media stuff, and I got, you know, I was lucky that some of the stuff that my lab was doing was attracting a bit of attention. And I was on Quirks and Quarks, and Bob McDonald said, you know, you have a really good voice. You should do a podcast. And I thought, you know, if Bob McDonald tells you to do a podcast, you probably should. And then that comment came up a couple of times. So one plus of the pandemic is I found myself with some spare time at home. So I just said, all right, let's have a podcast. So it's called That Neuroscience Guy. It's supposed to be the neuroscience of daily life. So our very first episode was on the neuroscience of impulse shopping. So why do people impulse shop? How do you explain it? Since then, we've sort of talked about anything and everything. Our episode last Sunday was on the neuroscience of indecisiveness and why some people are, but trying to frame it in terms of real, like I do mention parts of the brain and stuff, but it's really designed for someone that doesn't know anything about the brain, just to explain, you know, why they do the dumb things they do.
And, it sounds perfect.
And to be fair,
I'm listen to it.
I'm guilty about most of the things on the podcast. So we're having a lot of fun with it. I'm really lucky. I've got two amazing graduate students that said, "Yeah, we'll help out. This is cool." So we're just having fun with it. So it's I'm pleased that it's growing, and it's just fun I look forward to recording every week. It's just kind of fun.
Good. And that's good for your brain if you're looking forward to doing something every week.
Yeah, that's one thing in terms of what, you know, we were talking about what people can do in a situation like the pandemic is trying to think of things you can do that sort of keep you motivated and engaged, as opposed to just going for the binge watching of, and I'm guilty of this one myself, binge watching of television shows.
Mm. And you also you're still running your lab, right?
Yep. We were able to stay open for pretty much all of the pandemic. Some of the research that we do is deemed essential. So we're just going into phase two of a really cool project where we're looking at diagnosing or rapid diagnosis of dementia and Alzheimer's. So right now, one of the big problems with dementia and Alzheimer's is typically the disease is detected, you know, many years after disease onset, because it's a lot of the early signs are very similar to what you'd expect with normal aging. The actual diagnosis is quite complicated. It requires, you know, very long assessments by trained medical professionals. So one of the things we do in my lab is we use sort of what we call mobile brainwave technology. They're basically headbands that allow you to measure someone's brainwaves in a couple minutes from an iPhone. So one of the projects we were working on through the pandemic was basically saying, well, do we believe the brainwaves of people with Alzheimer's and dementia are different than the brainwaves of those at someone that doesn't have those conditions? So I was working with a colleague of mine, Dr. Alex Henry Bargava. He's a medical doctor here in Victoria, and he runs something called the Cognitive Health Initiative. And we just said, well, let's just try it. So our preliminary data, we're just preparing for publication, is we can do it. So in a couple of minutes, we can separate brainwave patterns from people that have dementia and Alzheimer's to people that don't have it. And what's really cool about that is that you could imagine that this tech can be deployed. Like my son used this mobile tech for his science fair project this year. So you can imagine building an assessment tool that runs off a phone that takes a couple of minutes. And we can't cure Alzheimer's or dementia, but if we can get early detection, that allows early intervention and the treatments, you know, and there's still no cure for these things, but early intervention always leads to better long-term medical outcomes. So we were able to keep that project alive through the pandemic. And we're moving into a phase now where we're expanding our testing. We're about to put a couple ads in the local newspaper to try to grow our sample size from, you know, about 100 people to 1,000 would be an ambitious goal. So we're still doing science. It looks a bit different. I was in the lab this morning and everyone was there and it was kind of like back to work as normal.
Wow. I love talking to you, Olav. I really do. And I can't thank you enough for being here and chatting with us again. And yeah, I can't believe it's been a couple of years since we spoke. So thank you so, so much for your time. I just want to remind people that you can visit Dr. Krigolson's website, which is Olav, O-L-A-V, Krigolson, KRIGOLSON.com. And you can also follow Olav on Twitter and Instagram at that NeuroSciGuy. Thanks again, Olav. I really appreciate your time.
Well, thank you, Tamara, so much for having me. It's always a pleasure and always a great conversation.